first, thank you very much for having me. It is Valentine's Day. My wife didn't care that I came here because we're too old to care about Valentine's Day. But some of you, why are you here? But I'm glad that you are here. That's good. That's wonderful. I've never been to Spring Arbor before, so this is nice. I like getting out and seeing other schools and other people, meeting them. And, you know, you don't know me, right? I don't know you. But we have a lot in common, right? And some of us, at least, we're trying to figure all this Jesus and Bible and God stuff out. And I think that puts us in a collection of people who have a common interest. And so I don't take for granted the chance to talk and to give you some of my ideas, you know, because I'm not here to, like, argue. In a sense, I'm not here to convince you that I'm right about things. I was asked to come talk about the Bible, and I'll just talk for a while about what I think is going on, what's happening there, and why that's important to know. And that's my point of view, and we'll have a chance for some, I guess, discussion and questions afterwards. Robbie, I'm counting on you to keep this on time. Achtung, yeah, right? The German thing. I'm a German, so I get all into time and stuff. I do have a watch on, but I know we have time constraints, and I'm going to be very cognizant of that. So, all right, well, let's just get into this here. Here's the question that has been part of my life since my 20s. And I remember the day when this question began to be formulated in my mind. I was having lunch with one of my professors in graduate school, and he was asking me, why are you here? Which is a good question to ask. Why are you studying the Bible for all these years, and then with the plan of going out and teaching the Bible for all those years? Why are you doing this? And as we were talking, it hit me. I had really personal reasons for that. And the reason is basically this. I want to know what the Bible is. And that's a good question to ask. So the question that came to me was, what interests me about this? I want to know, what is the Bible anyway? And what do we do with it? And that's a question that is, I think, not a bad... There are two questions, actually. I don't think those are bad questions to be asking ourselves pretty much all the time. Because the Bible throws curveballs at you when you think you have it figured out. And I think just keeping those questions in front of us is a spiritually formative and powerful thing to do. So now, you know, here I am about 30 years later, and I sort of have an answer to those questions. And I could be wrong. But I sort of feel like, you know, this is where I am at this moment. What is the Bible and what do we do with it? Let me tell you what the Bible isn't. I don't think the Bible works good as a rule book. I don't think it works as a cookbook. You know, here's the recipe to turn out the perfect Christian or something like that. I don't think it's like a legal document, right? That you follow everything that's written there, and if you do, then God's going to be happy with you. And if not, God's going to sue you. Because God's fundamentally angry, right? I don't think the Bible works well as sort of an owner's manual for the Christian life. I'm not saying there's nothing of value in the Bible. I'm just saying it doesn't work fundamentally as an owner's manual for life, or sort of like a Christian field guide. You know, find the verse you need right now, and that'll get you through. I don't think it works well that way. What we're doing, in my opinion, when we're reading the Bible is we're eavesdropping on an ancient journey of faith. Or to switch metaphors, we're eavesdropping on, not eavesdropping, we're watching a pilgrimage of people from long ago. And folks, I never get tired of saying this, this is long ago stuff, right? We're as far removed today from the time of David, backwards, as we are removed from the year 5000 in the future. If you just think about that for a second. And let's throw Abraham in there for the sake of it. That's another 1,000 years or so. When we're reading the Bible, we are being present with something that's very, very old. And I think we lose sight of that sometimes. And it's written over, I mean, it depends on who you ask, roughly, our Bible, roughly over about a 1,000-year period of time, which is a long time. Written by different people, at different times, different places, under different circumstances, for different reasons. And as a result, what we read in the Bible, and those of us who are avid Bible readers, you know this, even if you don't want to admit it, you know this is true. The Bible is pretty diverse. And the biblical authors give different points of view sometimes on the same topic. So I think of the Bible as, I mean, another analogy, maybe this helps, I don't know. Not a room full of omniscient people who are always exactly on the same page regardless, but I think of them more as a room of wise elders who have experienced things, who have experienced God, and have put those experiences in the words that make sense in the context in which they lived. What I have up there, the title, God Lets His Children Tell the Story. One of my seminary professors, bless his heart, he is of blessed memory, he died about 10 years ago, but he once said, the Bible looks the way that it does, very untended, a little bit messy, because God lets his children tell the story. And they tell the story from their point of view. They don't tell the story from an omniscient point of view, they tell it from their point of view. It's like, you know, a 7-year-old girl telling the story in show and tell about what her mommy does all day, right? It's probably accurate. It's not the whole picture. Some of it's probably wrong, but it's out of love. It's out of her experience of her mother. Or like, this is more my story, being a middle school boy and telling the story of our dads on the playground. Like, my dad picked up the back of a car once, right? There are ways of telling the story in the playground if you want your friends to know that your dad's actually awesome. There are ways of telling that story that only makes sense in the schoolyard, and you can't break those rules. See, there's a culture in the schoolyard. There's a way of talking, and that's what you do. I could not say what I did say later on in my 20s and 30s. Dad wore an apron and helped my mom do the dishes. Right? That's not going to work when you're 12. Right? See, the Bible is told from the point of view of real people experiencing God, sometimes questioning God, sometimes arguing with God, coming to different points of view. That's what we have. And what I like about that Bible is that it's actually encouraging because it mirrors our own journey of faith, which is diverse, which is sometimes up and sometimes down, sometimes even, right? It's not this thing that's inaccessible, like, I can never be like those biblical people. Oh, yeah, you can. You are all the time. Did you ever read this thing? Abraham's awesome. No, he's not. Moses, no, he's not. You know, none of these people are, right? You're reading a story of people actually struggling with their faith. All the time? No, not all the time, but it's there. And to me, that's a very encouraging thing to know about the Bible. It's something we can actually grab onto and connect with. So, what I would like to do here is, that's free advertising for my yellow book. I'm sorry, you know, I would never say, like, you have to read it or anything like that. You have to buy it, but I don't care if you read it at all, frankly. I don't. As long as you agree with me on everything I say. There are three issues that I'm sort of drawing it out of the book. I don't treat this very systematically necessarily in the book, but there are three issues I want to draw out that I think help illustrate how sort of diverse a story the Bible is. Actually, undeniably diverse the story of the Bible is. And the first one is how God thinks of outsiders and how the Israelites think of outsiders. People who aren't part of our tribe. The second is a little more subtle, but I think it's when you look at it, it's like, oh yeah, obviously. How the biblical writers talk about the past. Where did we come from? How did we get here? And a lot of you know this already. In the Old Testament, you have two stories of Israel. Not one, you have two. I want to talk about those for a couple minutes because it illustrates beautifully how the Bible, part it's written, its diversity is accountable on the basis of the fact that different people are writing it at different times for different reasons. They want to say different things. Okay. The third is God. And we'll just look at one quick thing there. Hopefully we'll have time for all these. If not, we'll just have to stop. But you know, the way God is talked about, it's not always the same way. It just depends on where you're reading. Which stands to reason. You know, God, it's hard to sort of wrap your arm, I don't know if you've noticed, am I the only one? It's hard to wrap your arms around God and say, okay, I got this now, right? I think the biblical writers are very much sometimes struggling with what is God like? What does God want from us, right? Okay, so let's look at the first one, the outsiders. And you got to start with the flood story very briefly here. Yeah, we when my kids were growing up, I have my children are 29, 26, and 23. When they were young, we had this plaque in our hallway. It was like a wooden plaque about this big, about this high. It was a scene, a panoramic scene of Noah's Ark, not too dissimilar from this. The only difference was there was Noah actually in it, who looked sort of like Santa Claus. And he was very happy. He was just smiling. I don't know why he's so happy, right? So, you know, here's the flood story, and it's the sixth chapter of the Bible, and everybody dies, except for one group of insiders. Instead of one group of people, everybody else drowns, right? I mean, think about this. By the sixth chapter of the Bible, God's solution is, I'm starting over. You know, get the eraser out, wipe everybody out. That's what, you know, God's promises never fail, which is what our plaque said too. It's like, I'm not sure if this is quite hitting the heart of this story. I think it's more something like this, right? Now, one day maybe I'll come back and we'll talk about the flood story and its theological importance in the narrative of Genesis. It's not just a weird story. Gee, I wish it weren't there. But the question is this telling us what God is like? Or is this telling us something about how people understood God to be in an ancient time and place? And I realize the implications of what I just said. Believe me, I live with those implications. I get it. We can talk about that, right? So you have the flood, and that's one thing. And this is like it opens with this insider-outsider thing. The big issue, of course, is that this is a painting of the conquest of Canaan. Right, another moment we have this perennial insider-outsider conflict in the Bible. Who are the insiders? The children of Abraham. Who are the outsiders? The people living in the land that you want. Right? So, I mean, one place here, Deuteronomy chapter 20, you must not let anything that breathes remain alive, you shall annihilate them. And you could also say exterminate them. Driving out the Canaanites doesn't quite do it, at least not in Deuteronomy's language, right? It's pretty serious stuff, you know. I mean, many of you, I'm sure, you know, remember this in 9/11, you know, when the planes went into the World Trade Center buildings. Right away, Christians I knew were saying, you see where Islam gets you? Religion of violence. Bad people, they fly stuff, you know, they just kill people they don't like, and people who are different than them, they just wipe them out. And, you know, anyone who's ever read the Bible, including atheists, are saying, like, yeah, have you ever read your Bible? You know, people are dying left and right. It's, you know, and it's usually at God's hand, right? So, okay, we have something to think through, don't we, about this, right? The thing is that it's not just that we have something to think through. The biblical writers were thinking through it. And not just in the New Testament where Jesus fixes everything, because he doesn't. Right? Within the pages of the Old Testament itself, here is the story of Achan and his family. If you know this one, right? Achan, this is after the Jericho thing, the walls fell. And this was called harem warfare. There's no test, you don't have to know that. But it's you know, everything is devoted to God, including all the treasury. You keep nothing. Why? annihilate everything, including beasts of the field. Men, women, it doesn't matter who, kill everything that has breath in it. Achan kept some of the booty for himself. So his punishment was that he and his family, well, basically would be treated like Canaanites. Stoned to death. Right, that's not a feel-good story, but I mean, that's, you know, this is, the penalty for that is being stoned to death. Here's the point. And others have said this. I mean, you know, we're going, flying over this at 30,000 feet. Just appreciate this. But others have said this too, and it makes a lot of sense to me. What we're seeing here is the biblical writers themselves discussing, what does it mean to be an insider or an outsider? Is it ethnicity? Is it just your bloodline? Or is it something bigger and deeper that has to do with the nature of God? Okay, actually, that's a good question. You know, modern people post 9/11 weren't the first people to struggle with this kind of stuff. Right, they did too. Another one, getting to Jesus, you know, Matthew and Mark both tell the story of the Canaanite woman who, I should say, of a woman whose daughter was possessed by a demon, tormented by a demon. And this woman goes to Jesus to basically beg him to help. And in Mark's gospel, this is a Syrophoenician woman, right? Which is basically, it's up there, out there. It's outside of the land of Judea, where you know the Jews live. She's a Syrophoenician woman. Matthew says she's a Canaanite woman. That's not an accident. Right, that's very intentional, and we could talk about Matthew's gospel and how Matthew does what he does and why he does it. We could talk about that for hours. Matthew's gospel makes her a Canaanite woman, and what's the end of that story, as many of you know? She says, help me. And Jesus says, nah, I'm just here for the children of Israel. People say, how can Jesus say that? He came to save the world. Jesus is playing with her. Or Jesus is trying to make a point, I'm only here for the children of Israel. And she begs. And Jesus says, you know what? You've got more faith than the people that I came here for, the Jews. So your faith is going to work. Not unlike Rahab in the Old Testament, the story of Jericho, who is a Canaanite woman, who gets it. You see, who's inside, who's outside? It's as if, see, Matthew is making this woman a Canaanite woman to make a point. Our hated enemies even have room. They even have a place in what I am doing here, in the name of the Father. Right? Inside or outside, what is that? In the Bible itself, we see movement. Another example, mainly because this is gory and I like talking about it. This is a relief. It's rather tall. It's not quite as tall as these windows, maybe about as long as these two rows of windows, but it's a relief of the siege of Lachish by Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, around 701. And it's sort of a bragging thing, you know. Lachish is a town south of Jerusalem because the Assyrians, who were a pain in the neck to the Israelites for basically their entire history, they come in and they are basically, it's a victory parade. They're taking over towns and they come to Lachish. And they do what they do with all the towns. They basically, we're here, we're going to win. You can either give up and be slaves and just do what we tell you to do, or you can fight and you'll die and we're still going to make you slaves. So whatever happened to Lachish, they probably didn't listen. So you've got these pictures here, which is hard to see, granted, but those guys on the top, they're impaled. Those are spikes coming up. Right. Assyrians were mean dudes. Well, that's the ancient world. People are just killing each other all over the place anyway, right? It's not a big deal. Here's another element of this relief. Again, a little bit hard to see perhaps, but these two figures here, they're not flying. They're being flayed. Probably flayed alive, skin peeled off. See, this is you don't mess with the Assyrians. This is what we do to our enemies. This is what we do to outsiders, right? This is why you have the prophet Nahum right? Talking about the fall of Nineveh, and let me just read what he says. This is how the book ends, okay? Your people, this is the, Nineveh is the capital of Assyria, right? So it represents the Assyrian Empire. Your people are scattered on the mountains with no one to gather them. There is no assuaging your hurt, your wound is mortal. All who hear the news about your about you clap their hands over you. For who has ever escaped your endless cruelty? That's how the book of Nahum ends. It's basically, there's a global high five because the Assyrians are wiped out, which is what happened in 612. In 612, the city of Nineveh fell. And Nahum, who is living around that time, is talking about that and saying, this is God's judgment on these wicked, horrible Assyrians that impale people and take their skin off. Right? Enter the book of Jonah. It's not hard to find a silly picture of Jonah on the internet, by the way, because it's a kid's story. It's not. Because there's an animal in it. Like the flood story, it's for kids. Anyway, small commercial. The Bible is an adult book for adults. How you handle it with kids takes a tremendous amount of wisdom and patience. And there's some stuff you should leave out. There. End of commercial. Okay, here's Jonah. Jonah and the salvation of Nineveh. And you know this story, but let me just read a little bit, a couple of verses here, how the book of Jonah begins. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. And we all know how this goes, right? Go tell them to repent. And Jonah says, yeah, I'm not doing that, because they might actually repent. We don't want the Ninevites to repent. We want them to be dead. Right? So the story goes on. And in chapter 3, he gives the shortest evangelistic sermon ever in the history of humanity. 40 more days and Nineveh should be overthrown. And then he leaves, right? And lo and behold, you know, there's fasting and repenting and all this stuff happens. And we read that at the end of the story, when God saw what they did, the Ninevites, how they repented and fasting and how the king led them in repentance, right? How they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity. God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, oh Lord, is this not what I said while I was still in my own country? I told you this would happen. This is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishment. We want punishment. I don't want you to forgive them. They're bad people. Right? And now, oh Lord, please take my life from me. Like a temper tantrum. He actually is throwing, the end of the book of Jonah, which never gets into VBS classes, is he's throwing a temper tantrum at the end. He's like, he's just sitting there, guys, he puts a plane over, just stay dry, just stay cool, you'll be fine. But he's like, I don't know why this is happening. I don't like why God does this. Right. So here's my point. Within the Old Testament, the Assyrians are just not good. There are a lot of good things said about the Egyptians. There's nothing good said about the Assyrians. Nahum says exactly what you expect him to say. Jonah, two books over, all of a sudden, God has a heart for the Assyrians. Why? How do you explain that? Well, you explain it because of when they were written. That explains it, right? Nahum is writing around the time of the historical moments. At that context, in that moment, you're cheering. I mean, I don't want to get political here, but if ISIS could be stopped almost by any means necessary, a lot of people, a lot of Christians, I think I'm one of them, would be saying, thank you, Lord. I mean, think about that. The Assyrians are like ISIS. Think of it that way. They just went through and they plundered and pillaged and raped, and that's what they did. And nobody can stop them. Go preach repentance. I want to give them a chance to repent. No, I'm not going to do that. Right? In the Bible, you have this dialogue happening about what to do with even the most heinous outsiders. name is written around the time of the events, let's say. Jonah is understood by every biblical scholar I know is to be later, to be an exilic or post-exilic text. Okay, who cares? What difference does that make? What is the exile? The Jews are captive in Babylon for 40 years or so before they come back. And there's something about travel that makes you think differently. Right? If you're raised, let's say, if you're born and raised in a foreign country hearing about this God, you know, and you live with people who are different than you. I mean, have you experienced this? I have many times. When I went to graduate school, right? Good meaning Christian friends said, don't talk to anybody, they'll affect you. They're bad people. They'll make you stop believing in Jesus and all that kind of stuff. What happened was I actually met these people. They're some of the nicest people I ever met. And I start thinking to myself, is God only on my side? Or what about these people, right? Okay, I see that mirrored. My own experience, I see that mirrored here in Nahum and Jonah. I was Nahum. I had some experiences, I become Jonah. In a sense, maybe there's something bigger happening here that I'm not accounting for. Within the Bible, we have this dialogue, which I think is wonderful. How does God feel about outsiders? Depends on what you're reading. Then, the last point here, looking at Jesus and Paul, you have Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, and, you know, he famously says, you know, you've heard it said, love your neighbor, hate your enemy, which isn't really in the Bible. The Bible nowhere actually says hate your enemy, but they sure act like it. You know, hate your enemy, love your neighbor. Who's your neighbor? Well, that's the Good Samaritan parable, but the neighbor in the Old Testament is your country folk, the people who are like you, right? Love your neighbor does not mean love the Assyrians in the Old Testament. It doesn't mean love Moabites or Edomites or Ammonites or anybody. It means your own fellow Jews, children of Abraham. You've heard it said, love your neighbor, hate your enemy. I say to you, love your enemy, pray for those who persecute you. Who's your enemy? Well, contextually, there's a really obvious answer to who their enemy is. It's not their roommate who leaves the toilet seat up or something. That's not your enemy. It's not your boss at work who's like is oppressing you. Your enemy is the Roman Empire. Gentiles in the midst of your land, which makes it very difficult for you to be Jewish. Right? Those are the enemies that Jesus is talking about. Why? Because, you know, the rain falls on everybody. The righteous, the unrighteous, the evil, the good. So here's what you do. Love your enemy, pray for those who persecute you. Because in doing so, you are children of God. Right? That's like a megaphone talking about outsiders. How do you handle them? You pray for them. There's no way of getting close to somebody more than praying for them, because it takes down barriers, you know. You pray for them. And then it says at the end, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect, which is usually, it freaks people out. I have to be perfect like God. No, you have to be perfect in love. You have to be complete in love. That's what it means. You love people the way God loves them too. Right? See, our Bible is moving on this whole issue of who's inside and who's outside. Famously, that's Paul and Peter. I don't know which one is which. I think Paul's on the right because he's balder or something. I don't know, but I don't know. Maybe, who knows? Who cares? Paul and Peter had a famous disagreement about one thing. What do you do with Gentiles? I love how the New Testament, the very beginning of the Christian story, there's diversity and disagreement even there. Right? You go the further back you go into the biblical story, it doesn't clear things up. It's actually pretty messy at times. And this is one of those places. What do you do with Gentiles? Good question. Can they be followers of Jesus? Yeah. And be connected to the God of Abraham? Yeah. They got to be Jewish first. That's sort of Peter's position, at least at first. But that's not Paul's position. They actually disagreed about that. And in Galatians, Paul says how Peter was just trying to make himself look good in front of other people by saying, yeah, Judaism is there. Yeah. But they disagreed about that. And that was a big deal, right? Because Jews had learned to be separate from Gentiles to survive. For how long? For hundreds and hundreds of years. Ever since the Babylonians came and wiped them out in the 6th century, they came back to the land to be faced with Persian Empire over them, and then the Greek Empire over them, and then the Roman Empire. They haven't had a minute's peace for 600 years. They had to learn how to be Jewish amidst this Gentile world. So when Jesus comes along and people say Jesus is the Messiah, and Gentiles are like, yeah, we want some of that. Jews, understandably, I think, were saying, yeah, that's fine, but you have to be sort of like us. You have to sort of, this is a Jewish faith. It's not a new religion. It's Judaism. You have to sort of follow the rules. And the two things you really need to do, I'll give you a minute. Brick Bible is awesome. My students love it. Circumcision. I love the expression on the guy's face. It's just hilarious. I'm sorry. That's Isaac being circumcised by Abraham, apparently. An artist's depiction, no doubt. And clean and unclean foods, right? See, I mean, a lot of you, I'm sure, know this, and not to go into too much detail, but sociologists talk about boundary markers. Groups have boundary markers to set them off from the world around them. Where I come from in Pennsylvania, we have the Amish. You have any Amish out here? Yeah. Right? Truly wonderful people. They have clear boundary markers of how they dress, right? Of what they drive or don't drive, of where they live, of who they hang out with, of what their practices are. They have a very different kind of lifestyle than I do. I know when an Amish person's coming at me. I see it, right? Well, Jews had boundary markers to say, how can we maintain our Jewish identity amid a Greco-Roman world that is not always friendly to us? One thing is maintain the covenant of circumcision that God gave to Abraham in chapter 17 of Genesis as an eternal covenant. No expiration date. And another thing, watch what you eat, right? Greeks and Romans eat anything. Jews have a list of do's and don'ts. Leviticus chapter 11, there are certain things you're not supposed to eat. So one way to maintain our distinctiveness is circumcision. Another way is dietary regulations. There were other things too, like Sabbath keeping and some other things. Right. There are insiders and outsiders. A lot of Paul's writings, especially Romans and Galatians, are about Paul breaking down what he calls the wall of hostility between these two groups, saying, here's the message of God. There is one God. There is one people of God, Jew and Gentile, not Jews saying, we have the law, and you don't, to Gentiles. And not Gentiles saying, what a bunch of weirdos, you don't eat lobster, right? It's leveling the playing field, right? I mean, this is Paul's argument through the entire book of Romans, culminating at the last part of the book where he talks about what you eat and what you don't eat. And he says, some of you are okay eating pretty much anything, others of you aren't. Well, let the stronger bear up the weaker brother. And who's the stronger brother? Think about this. The stronger one, brother and sister, the stronger one is the one who understands that what you eat doesn't matter. Which isn't what the Old Testament says, by the way. It says the exact opposite. You see, you've got this movement about what makes you an insider, what makes you an outsider. We're watching this we're almost watching these people thinking on their feet. Especially trying to account for Jesus, which is not an easy thing to account for. All right. The second point here, moving right along, is the two histories of Israel. Just to warn you, this is really boring, but really important. So lock the doors. Nobody's going anywhere for the next 5 minutes. Okay. There are two histories of Israel, as many of you know, 1 and 2 Samuel. 1 and 2 Kings is one. The other one is 1 and 2 Chronicles. If you ever like read through the Bible in a year, which I don't recommend, it's just a lot of stuff. You get to 1 and 2, if you get this far, it gets really repetitive. Anybody like read 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings? How many kings again? Okay, and they did wicked stuff and blah, 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 and they died. And the next one came. It's just, it gets a little bit tedious. So you read 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, and then right after it, you come to 1 and 2 Chronicles. And you say, I'm not reading that, I just read it. Only you didn't. See, that's the point. There are two different histories of Israel that cover much of the same ground, but in very different ways. 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings takes you from Samuel, who's the last judge, right, who anoints Saul, then anoints David, and then after David comes Solomon, and then after Solomon's death, you have the division of the monarchy into north and south. And then these books end with the exile, going into Babylon in 586. With the last king, Zedekiah, being blinded by Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian king, but not before Zedekiah saw his sons blinded. Killed. He was blinded, the sons were killed, correct, yeah. His sons were killed, which effectively cuts off the line, which is another issue, right? So that's that story. First and Second Chronicles is similar but different. It doesn't start with Samuel. It actually goes way back to the beginning. It starts with bad advice the author got. It starts with 9 chapters of names, right? I'm going to read through a chapter of the Bible in a day. Okay, that's a week and a half right there. Just knock yourself out with this. But it starts with Adam, but it tells the story of Saul rather quickly. And then David and Solomon at great length. And then it talks about Judah. Who's Judah? The southern nation. Remember the nation divided into north and south? This is the southern nation of Judah. And then the exile, but also the return from exile. Okay, so what? Well, here's the so what. One example, the stories of David and Solomon are told differently in these two stories. For example, Bathsheba. The story everybody knows, right? That's in the first version. The second version leaves that out. David's foibles. David was not perfect, by the way, right? But that's left out. Foreign wives, right? Solomon, the downfall of the kingdom, the cause for the division, was in part because Solomon started off okay, but at the end, he had all these foreign wives, and he's letting them worship their gods on their land and even in the temple, and it got pretty nasty. Okay, Chronicles leaves that out. Transition of power. You read 1 Kings, like the first couple of chapters, and the transition of power between David and Solomon is really interesting. It's full of like a Jerry Springer episode. It's very not, a lot of family dysfunction going on, right? And a lot of intrigue and whatever. In Chronicles, it pretty much goes like this. Hey, Solomon, here's the crown. That's it. It was a smooth transition of power, no political intrigue, right? The temple. Right. In 2 Samuel, it's very clear, David wants to build a temple for God. God says, no, Solomon's going to do it. Put it out of your mind. Never hear of it again. In 1 Chronicles, David doesn't build the temple, but for about, I don't know, 8-9 chapters, something like that, he does everything but build it. He has a fundraiser, he collects the materials, he gets it all ready, and David is a central person, and then he sort of hands it over to Solomon, right? It's sort of like, you know, a father who says to his or her, you know, child, son or daughter, listen, you need to live on your own. So I'm going to find you an apartment, I'm going to buy you a car, I'm going to pay for all your insurance. I'm going to give you a monthly allowance, right? It's like you're doing it, but you're not really doing it. It's the father who's making it all happen. That's how the temple construction is talked about in 1 Chronicles. David has a powerful role that is utterly out of the picture in that first telling of the story. These are two different versions. One, a quick example, the divided kingdom. Here, north and south, the north is called confusingly Israel, the south is called Judah. In Chronicles, they don't even talk about the north. They just talk about Judah. They just talk about the south, right? And they say things like, you know, there's no northern kingdom. I mean, there is a northern kingdom, but they just don't waste time talking about it because Judah is the important one. Why? Because Judah survived. That's why. And one other example. Just one example of how this author treats the history of Israel differently. Manasseh, wicked King Manasseh in 2 Kings, he is the worst person ever in the history of the solar system. He does nothing right. He is, in fact, he's the cause of the exile. That's what 2 Kings says. After him, Josiah came along. He was the perfect king. He cleaned everything up. He got everything in order. But God said, you know what? I hear you. It's not good enough. I'm so mad at Manasseh, I'm going to send you into exile. In Chronicles, 2 Chronicles, Manasseh is not the cause for the exile. In fact, what Manasseh did was he repented of his sins and he prayed and God forgave him and restored him. That's a little bit different, ain't it? Now, let me tell you something. The author of Chronicles was very much aware, probably, of this history, which is much older. He's probably aware of it. And I don't think he's trying to trick anybody. I hope they don't notice how I tell this story differently, right? But they're telling the story differently because they have different things to get across, right? The when explains the why, right? Why are these two stories different? When they were written helps us understand why they were told the way that they were. So here's a timeline. I like timelines. This covers about 1,000 years. David around 1,000, give or take a half a century. 722 BC, Israel, the northern kingdom, is exiled by those Assyrians, right? 586 BC, Judah, the southern nation, is exiled by the Babylonians. They come back 539 BC. And Jesus shows up. Not in the year zero, the way my students keep saying. There is no year zero, just AD 1, right? There's Jesus. All right, so here's the thing. Samuel and Kings were probably written around this time, around the time of going into exile and being into exile, maybe coming back from exile. Maybe the very beginning. It was written around this time. You've got a long period of time there after that. 5th, 4th, and 3rd centuries BCE is probably the time that Chronicles was written. 200-300 years later. One reason people say that is because it talks about the return from exile, and it also talks about figures that lived in the 5th century, like the mid-400s. So clearly it's written, that's part of that, why that boring genealogy is actually semi-important. It gives you a clue as to when this stuff was written, right? These two stories of Israel written at different times to get something different across, and so they told the story differently, right? Samuel Kings is sort of asking and answering a question. What did we do to have that happen to us? Why was God so mad at us? And the answer was, they were punished because they disobeyed the covenant, especially the kings encouraging the people to false worship. How did we get into this mess? Here's the story. Chronicles is asking a different question. Has God abandoned us? Why would they ask that? Well, okay, we're back in the land. We came back in 539. We've been back for a while, but the Persians are over us. And then later the Greeks are over us. Things are not restored. They're not the way they should be. Something is still very, very wrong with this picture. And you know what? I don't know about you, but if God seems like a no-show in your people's lives for a few centuries, you start asking yourself, where is God? Has God abandoned us? Does God care? Does God even know what we're going through? Chronicles is in part about a struggling with God's absence. See, Samuel and Kings, they're being browbeaten. Chronicles is like a sermon. It's a pep talk. It's an encouragement. And so we see things like in Chronicles, hope for the future. It doesn't say, it retells the story of Israel, accenting things like a hope for the future, a renewed Davidic monarchy. The reason why David and Solomon are portrayed as pretty much flawless characters isn't because they believe that about David and Solomon. It's because those two figures were a vision that modeled something for their future. This is what our monarchy is going to look like one day. This is what God has in store for us. So they tell the story of the past, not to talk about the past, to talk about their present and about their future hope. So they tell the story in such a way that gives encouragement to the people. Right. And also a renewed commitment to the covenant and a renewed commitment to obedience to the law of God and to temple worship and things like that. Right. See, what I find fascinating about this is how how the book of Chronicles is very future-oriented about a Davidic king sitting on the throne. Then we'll know that God has not abandoned us. Then and only then. We're back in the land, thank you very much. We rebuilt the temple, thank you very much. There's no king sitting on the throne. Until that happens, God is absent. Chronicles, as boring as the book can be, is the most messianic book in the Old Testament because it's looking forward to a solution, a son of David sitting on the throne. Enter Jesus, who doesn't do what you think he's supposed to do. You're not supposed to die, you're supposed to live. You're not supposed to be executed by the Romans, you're supposed to defeat the Romans, right? But that's why, I mean, that's a whole other story, but how the Gospels themselves, which we'll talk about here in a second, the Gospels feed off of that hope and then utterly and completely redefine it. Okay, talking about the past is diverse. It's a little bit messy. Biblical authors are not on the same page. That carries over into the New Testament, and you all know there are four Gospels. Am I going too fast for you, right? There are four Gospels. They tried, like in the second century, the church tried to ram them all together into one big Gospel, because four is confusing. Let's make one out of them, and they gave up after a while. It lasted for a few decades, and people said, this won't work, because they're too different. They're too diverse. That's why they say the gospel according to Matthew, the gospel according to Luke, etc. That's a good thing. Very quickly here, the birth story in Matthew, chapters 1 to 3, you recognize some of that. You know, Matthew 2 begins with a genealogy, but it's an important one, which we won't talk about. An angel comes to Joseph, then there's the birth of Jesus, and then the famous story of the wise men, they escape to Egypt, Herod massacres the innocents, right? Then they return to Judea, and then John the Baptist, and all that. Luke's birth story is different. Okay? It's very different. They're not saying the same thing. I mean, for what it's worth, you know, Luke's is longer. He's a bit wordy. Luke really is. He just keeps going here. But, you know, he has, for example, not an angel appearing to Joseph, but he has an angel appearing to Mary, and he names him Gabriel. Little detail that's different. What's really interesting for me, the differences are right here, right? It's Luke that has the shepherds and the angels singing, right? How many of you have ever been in a Christmas pageant in church? Or had the misfortune of watching one every year for about 15 years, right? We're always, it's the wise men and the shepherds are all together. So we harmonize, we bring them together, which is fine. I don't care what you do, right? But the stories are different and they're told differently. And we can go on and on like this for hours. I'm not. I just want to say one thing. Matthew's Jesus, this isn't just my opinion, this is pretty standard stuff. Matthew's Jesus looks like Moses. He does it on the Sermon on the Mount. He says, you have heard it said, but I say to you, you know, you have heard it said, don't murder, I say to you, if you hate somebody in your heart. He's quoting the Ten Commandments. He says, you have heard it said, but I say to you. And where's Matthew sitting when he says this? On a mountain. Moses is the new Moses on a mountain giving law to his people. That's one way of Matthew portraying Jesus to his probably largely Jewish audience. And Jesus' birth is like Moses' childhood. Right, escaping the edict of a crazy king who's killing everybody, and he escapes and winds up doing something pretty big. Luke's story of Jesus and his birth is very, very different. For Luke, who's a Gentile, his Jesus is not the new Moses. His Jesus is Caesar. He's the better world ruler. For example, Luke makes a big deal out of Jesus being called Son of God. Well, obviously, yeah, that's what Caesar called himself. Right. Jesus, Luke's Jesus is Savior, who brings good news to the people. Well, that's exactly how Caesar was described, as Savior of the people, bringing good news to them. It's not that Jesus is the new Moses. Luke probably wouldn't have had a problem with that, but that's not how he describes Jesus. For his audience, for their needs, Jesus is the true king, right? So you have these two versions. Then you have Mark, who just leaves it out entirely. Apparently, it's not important. And John blows the whole thing up. He puts Jesus at the beginning of creation, calling him the Word, but there's no birth story. By the way, there's no baptism story in John either, which is interesting. Jesus isn't baptized as he is in the other Gospels, and there may be some interesting reasons. The point is that there are four Gospels. Why are they different? They didn't compare notes? No, actually, if you listen to what biblical scholars generally say, and I think this is generally right, Mark's is the earliest Gospel. Matthew and Luke were in some sense dependent on Mark, and they changed it anyway. They weren't doing a research paper saying, I want to stick to my source and repeat it exactly. They changed it. Why? Because it's okay. You're telling a story of Jesus for your audience, for their needs, for their time. Right? There's something being modeled here for us, folks. I'm trying to get a handle on it. There's something about how the Bible behaves that is helpful to us. Instead of feeling the pressure, I got to cram, well, they can't contradict. We know that. We know how God works, so God would never do this. He gave us four to see how smart we are to make them into one. And I hope I pass that theology exam. And he gave us two histories of Israel that are so different, but they only look different. They're not really different. If I try really hard, I can cram them together into one story. I think we're really disrespecting the text when we do that. Let them be what they are. Let those stories tell the story the way they are. Don't bring our modern preoccupation with things like historical accuracy into the ancient texts. There, I just yelled at you, but I didn't mean that. Don't take it personally. So, all right. I think, what is it? It's a little before 8. All right, I'll do the last one like in about 3 seconds. Only because there were like really cool pictures here. These are, let me just start with the punchline. The Old Testament is monolatrous, not monotheistic. Right? Monolatry or henotheism, they mean the same thing. Is that term familiar to anybody? Here? No? Well, it will be now. Okay, ready? Monolatry means, it comes from mono, meaning one, and latry, meaning worship. Monolatry means acknowledging the existence of multiple gods, but only one of them is worthy of worship. That's pretty much what the Old Testament does. The New Testament's a little different. We'll get to that, right? In the Old Testament, the Israelites aren't polytheistic. They don't worship multiple gods. Well, sometimes they do, and that's a problem. Israelite religion is monolatrous. Other gods exist, but only one God is worthy of worship. There's an example of a Mesopotamian pantheon of gods. I'll give you one guess as to which one is the high god of that pantheon, right? So, this is cool. This is a depiction of an Egyptian pantheon. It looks like the cast of Cats on Broadway, but that's why I like to have it out there. But that's the thing for the Israelites. The Israelites, you know, the Egyptian experience. And if you read the plague stories, for example, the plague stories seem to be God doing battle with the gods of Egypt and winning. In fact, quite easily winning, right? First, he turns the Nile to blood. Well, there is a Nile god, right? Hapi, right? The second plague, the plague of frogs. What happens to the frogs? They multiply, which isn't cute. It's a disaster. But, you know, the Egyptian goddess of fertility, Heket, had the face of a frog. There's something going on there with saying, which god is worthy of worship? Well, the one that beats the other ones up, that's the one who's worthy of worship. right? So you have that. And here, you know, this is a depiction of sort of like a Yahwistic pantheon, they call it. But you have Psalms like Psalm 82 and 95, just one line from Psalm 82. God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. It's like there's a board meeting. And he sits down, and he basically, in Psalm 82, he berates the other gods for not doing their job. You ever read Job 1 and 2? Right? Job begins with a heavenly boardroom scene with the other gods. It's sort of like it's a weekly staff meeting almost. Like, how's it going down there? Yeah, pretty good. And then this one divine being, the accuser, Satan, says, yeah, if you push Job, I bet you he'll crack. Right? It's this interesting little boardroom scene here. That's because the Israelites were monolatrous. Only one God is worthy of worship, but they acknowledge the existence of others. It's sort of like, I mean, there's no real modern analogy for this, but you probably all don't bank in the same place. Probably, by a show of hands, of how many different banks you go to, whether it's whatever you call them out here, you know, Wells Fargo or just whatever we have out east, that's normal. See, it's normal to have variety in where you bank. It's normal to not go to one branch in your hometown when you need money. Where do you get it from? You go online, you transfer money that way, you go to ATMs, which are about 7 on each corner, and in churches, and you know, in the 7-Eleven, whatever. What if a decree were to come down that, hey people, my church, you're going to be different. You're only going to bank in one place. That branch on Main Street, that branch on Main and Elm, that's the only place where you go. You can't go wherever you want to. You may not go to an ATM. You can't just draw money out wherever you want to. That's what the Israelites were told. You can't worship God wherever you want to. You worship him in one place, Jerusalem and the temple, and you only worship this God in this specific way. See, when we think of the ancient Israelites as monolatrous, it sounds like, oh, they believed in other gods. Yeah, but in the ancient world, them's fighting words, right? Everybody had a multiplicity of gods. Everybody acknowledged a very active heavenly realm. But the Israelites were told, only one is worthy of worship. You don't really feel the pain of that without understanding something of the context in which the Israelites lived. How they were being asked to do something which is absolutely crazy. It's counterintuitive. It makes no sense. Now, what I believe happens is as time goes on, just stop beating around the bush here. Couple quick scenes here. What happens is over time, I believe, the Israelites came to have more clarity about, you know, I think there's only one. I'm not sure there's other, whatever they are, they're not really gods. There's an active divine realm, but they don't have any real power. Only our God has power. That's that famous thing with Elijah, right, in 1 Kings with the prophets of Baal. And Elijah is cool because he's sarcastic. Do I have his? Oh, yeah. Right? Like, which God is more powerful, right? Call down fire from heaven, and the prophets of Baal, nothing. They're cutting themselves. They're dancing frantically to try to conjure this God up to make fire. And at noon, it says, noon, Elijah mocked them, saying, prophets of Baal, whatever, however many there are, he mocked them, saying, cry aloud. Surely he is a god. Either he is meditating or he has wandered away, which many commentators think is a euphemism for taking a bathroom break. This is I love the Bible. Cry aloud, surely he is a god. Either he is meditating or he's taking a potty break or he's on a journey and perhaps he's asleep and he must be awakened, right? And then this story, of course, goes, the altar is doused with water and fire comes down from heaven, consuming the prophets of Baal. Why not? Right. So, you know, you have this notion in 1 Kings, like, maybe they're not even really there. Right. And Isaiah, the same thing. In Jeremiah, they have this little thing about, what the heck are you doing making a god out of a piece of wood? You take the tree, you chop it down. With half of it, you build a fire and you cook your meat and you warm your hands and you say, ah, I am warm, Isaiah 44. And with the other half of it, you make a god and you worship it. It's like they're saying, think about this, people. Does this make any sense? Why would you do this? What is absurd? Bell and the Dragon is from the Apocrypha. By the way, Apocrypha is a lot of fun, too. Daniel is the main character. The Daniel of the Bible is the main character. Bell and the Dragon, the first scene, is where the Babylonians, their god, is given meat each night. The doors of the temple are closed. They're barred shut. Nobody can get in, like police tape or something, right? And lo and behold, the next morning, the meat's gone. Well, the gods are eating them, right? So Daniel says, there are no gods eating it. He goes, how do you know? Just leave it to me, right? So what happens is the next day, before they close the door, he takes ash and he sprays it on the floor. And the next morning they wake up and they see footprints coming from a hidden chamber out to the altar and then back again. So what happens is the priests are hiding. So no one's breaking the seal. Nobody's getting in. They're in there from the very beginning. They have a secret passage. They come get the meat and they go out again. So this is Daniel proving that there's no God. This other story here is the dragon is revered as a god, and Daniel gives it a mixture of like pitch, hair, and something else, I forget. It's this grotesque thing, and he eats it, and he blows up, right? I mean, these are not true stories. They're stories to illustrate the point that in this period of time, the Apocrypha is intertestamental. We're getting very close to the New Testament era here. And it's like they're mocking the idea of these other gods having anything worth even thinking about, right? And then you get to Paul, and this is the last slide. Monotheism in Paul's day, in my opinion, is pretty sure. Something happened by the time you get to Paul and the New Testament, and not just the followers of Jesus, but Jews, monotheism was like, yeah, duh, obviously. There is only one God. This is a curious thing, and we'll end with this. 1 Corinthians 8, he says, hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, which is a bad idea if you're a Jew. You don't want to do that because it breaks that boundary marker, right? But we know that no idol in the world really exists and that there is no God but one. Even though there may be so-called gods in heaven and on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, and I think what Paul is saying there is, again, this act of sort of divine realm. There's something going on, perhaps. Right? But yet there's for us only one God, the Father, from whom are all things and from whom we exist, et cetera, et cetera. Right? I'm not exactly sure what Paul's saying, but I will say this. We're a long ways away from that Egyptian pantheon or Mesopotamian pantheon. We've moved. The biblical story has changed. It's progressed where in Paul's day, Jews are assuming things about the divine realm that they were not assuming, let's say, 500 years earlier. There's movement, there's change in the biblical story. So let me just end with this. That's why I think the Bible is actually very interesting, because we can connect with it. What we're seeing, what I'm seeing in the Bible, and maybe you're seeing it too, is evidence of a people, a diverse people, over a long period of time, on a journey of, can I put it this way? I don't want to be misunderstood, of sort of growing up. And I don't mind saying of progressing, right? I think of portions of the Bible as like a five-year-old and how God allows that five-year-old to tell the story the way he or she sees it. And then other portions of the Bible, they're like teenagers, you know, and they're complaining a bit more, but they're still thinking, and they're making this story their own, and we see this movement, and maybe Jesus is like an adult or something in this metaphor, right? It's like, and we're seeing something bigger and different, and that smashes some of the categories of the Old Testament and encourages and draws upon some others, right? So we have movement in the Bible. We have a story that's being told that I think is encouraging to us. It's a book that we can relate to. It's a book that we can actually watch a debate happen. Differences of opinion happen. I've learned many things from Jewish scholars and professors who seem to have their act together about an awful lot that Christians don't. One of them is the nature of the Bible. And they love the fact that there is debate and disagreement, because that's what they do all the time, right? Rachel Held Evans, you probably know who she is. She has this book, A Year of Biblical Womanhood, and she tells a story in there of befriending an older Jewish woman, and she was at her house one day, and her husband was over with a lot of his rabbi buddies, and they were basically arguing about Torah for hours. And Rachel said to this older woman, she says, how do you stand it? And she says, are you kidding? Look at what's happening, right? You have people here communing with God through debating with the text. And that forms community, that forms coherence. It's not about I'm right and you're wrong, I can't associate with you anymore. It's actually the debate and the disagreement that forms Christian community, in this case, Jewish community. All I'm saying is that I see that in the pages of the Bible itself. That's continuing a tradition of communing with God honestly, trying our best to come to terms with who God is. We're seeing that modeled in the Bible itself. And I think, to me, that's a very encouraging thing. Okay, I'm a little past what I wanted to be. I'm so sorry, but, Robbie, what do you think? Do you wanna, I'm very happy to, if people have a couple questions, and I'll let you end us when we need to end.
Yeah, we've got about 10 minutes.
Okay, that's fine.
All right. If that's okay.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
So raise your hand and I'll run around with a mic for you to ask those easy questions. And Pete, if you could repeat the question into for the recording.
You're good. It's okay. I took it out so he doesn't have to.
Oh.
You don't have to repeat the questions. You're good.
We're going to start over here, Dan, just because she's closer.
So I have three, if you don't want to answer some. I did take Dr. Tom's class, so I haven't read Inspiration and Incarnation.
Did you buy it?
Not yet.
Hey, next question.
So, what about Inspiration? Your story of progress, are we still progressing? If so, is the canon closed?
Those are very different kinds of questions. What is Inspiration? That is exactly what I think needs to be a continued topic of conversation among Christians. Now, like, it works this way. I happen to think that the nature of inspiration is not at all incompatible with movement and change and progress. Why do I say that? Because I just see that happening all over the place in the Bible. So we need language to talk about inspiration that allows for, let's say, that earthiness and contextualness of the Bible, which is sort of what I talk about in that book you have to write. That's okay, though. My kids haven't read that book. My kids hate it. Anyway. But you know, is progress continuing? See, I happen to think, I actually believe that it is. Although I don't say that lightly and like anything goes, but I think we're beyond where Paul was in terms of slavery. Why? Because I think the Spirit of God is still active in the world. And I think that doesn't stop. And I think that automatically means some sort of progress. Is the canon closed? That's a very, well, actually, yes, it is closed, because no one functionally can open it up again. Just de facto, it is closed. You can't open it. But I would like to see Christians adopt a more robust, I would say, Jewish mentality in terms of what the Bible is. I shouldn't say Jews think, because Jews have different opinions just like Christians do. I hate when people say Christians think this. No, I don't think that. I never don't make me think that. Right. But by and large, I would say it is a property of Judaism to understand that the Bible itself is tradition because it's changing and moving and evolving. They've continued that in their own Talmudic tradition. So in other words, the tradition of wise people and elders engaging God and engaging their tradition hasn't stopped. However, they also have a clear notion that Torah and Talmud are not the same thing. In other words, medieval commentary is not on the same level as Torah, but yet they're continuing the discussion. So for them, the question of canon is a closed, well, yeah, it's closed, but it doesn't matter. We still have to keep thinking about this. It's a different way of thinking about the Bible, which I totally understand if we have 10 hours to go. To me, it's like the Bible drives me in that direction. I don't know what else to do with this stuff, because it's just so untended. It's not neat. It's encouraging a process that I think is a very, very important one. So,
thank you very much. I really enjoyed this. And I believe that the purpose of worship is to rehearse the story of God. That's what the church does when we gather. Mm-hmm. And so this is kind of a so what question. I feel like I've worshiped tonight because we have rehearsed for us so much of the story of God in relationship to us. I wonder if you could just give me advice as someone who teaches an adult Sunday school class at church of how I can, your topic was God lets his children tell the story. I get to tell this story whenever and I just wonder if you have some suggestions on a direction that pastors and teachers ought to take in light of the story we have, and how, what are the boundaries of how we adapt the story to culture?
Right. Thanks for the easy question. Where are the boundaries that keep us from getting it wrong? Right. I think that is part of the journey of the people of God to be in a process of figuring out what some of those boundaries might be, and it might even change from context to context. But I can only speak from my experience. What I think we can do is, as best as we can, not feel like we have to protect the Bible, but let the biblical story just be told. That's what I do with my students. I mean, with my undergraduate students at Eastern, my job is to tell them the biblical story. It's not always to tell them what I think about the biblical story. Just try to tell the story as best as I can. Because when they do that, they start seeing things themselves. Why is this told differently here than here? Okay, now, as I tell my students, welcome to adult Bible reading. Now you're getting it. Now you're generating that question. So it's almost like talk about anything. Right? There's no 10-week series here, right? There's a 10-lifetime series. There's no 10-week series. What's your passion? What are you interested in? What do you really like talking about and thinking about? Do that and let that sort of come out to the people, your enthusiasm, your love for this stuff. And telling the biblical stories with integrity and with honesty, which is hard to do in some Christian contexts, right? I mean, it is. I get it. I understand. Like, wait a minute, you're supposed to give me the answers, not tell me I have to think about this on my own. So I get it. I understand that. Anybody else? I know it's balanced.
No, I'll say going once, going twice.
So!
All right, thank you.
Is this just a sympathy question to make me feel good? I'm actually fine. I mean, I don't like, anyway, go ahead.
In what you've told us tonight, what's the risk? What's the failure?
There's always risk in life and in the life of faith. The risk is that we have to surrender to God, which none of us like to do. We have to surrender to a life of trusting God, a life of true faith, where we don't control God through the text, but where the text becomes an access point for communing with God that changes for us over time. In other words, this is now an uncontrolled process that we have to trust God to control. That's very risky. I don't know if that answers your question, but it does for me. Right? Maybe you're thinking of other kinds of risks. See, for example, a risk is, well, then people might be confused. That's a small risk. I mean, forgive me, folks. I mean, that's a childish risk. And I don't mean that in a negative, like, pouting, like, angry at you kind of way, but that is the risk of ambiguity is one you have to embrace the older you get in the faith. I'm still trying to figure that out, by the way. And I teach this stuff. As Paul says, I have not arrived. You know, I haven't. I'm working on it. But it's the risk of letting go. This is my talk tomorrow. It's the risk of the need to be certain. It's a risk of letting go of the need to have it all ironed out instead of submitting yourself to God and trusting God. Guess what? The Bible really encourages that process. It's not giving you what you want. It's not giving you the rule book. It's not giving you a notebook. It's not giving you any of that stuff. It's giving you a story, which is diverse and which is messy and which is untended and which I would not write this way, ever. I'd cut it in half, first of all. It's too long. I'd have one history of Israel that gets it right, not two that say two different things. I'd have one story of Jesus. You know that meme on Facebook? You ever see Jesus? It's the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus is a painting, and he's got his hand up like this. And Jesus says, now listen up, everybody. I don't want like four versions of this running around. Right? I get it. I would do it that way.
Are we have time for maybe one more question? Is there one more question out there?
I got a good one. Just bring it a whole home.
I got one.
Okay.
I don't know if it's that good.
Wait for the wait for the mic.
So I don't know. This might have to do more with the sin of certainty you talked about, but I won't be able to make that one. So I wanted to ask this if I could. In this uncertainty, you talk about this descent into like a mind shaft, and this idea that the farther down you get, it gets scary, it gets uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. But truly, the only way to figure out a way out is just to get out and start walking in that uncomfortable space. Mm-hmm. Kind of paralleling that with your journey of maybe deconstruction. Mm-hmm. Now, I just recently read the story from Plato, what's that called? The Allegory of the Cave.
Yeah.
Can you talk about if there's any similarities to the man who makes it out of the cave and that descent down the mine shaft?
I mean, I think they're similar. I wasn't thinking about it at all when I just used that little homie analogy, but it is about, I don't mind calling it enlightenment, and seeing, my goodness gracious, the path is a very different one than my little world allowed me to assume all those years. It's actually a thicker reality because I have to go through scary places before I get there. Because scary disarms you. You're out of control. We all want to be in control. I know I do. I'm German. I'm a white German intellectual. I'm all about control. Ask my wife, ask my kids. It's the family joke, right? It doesn't work, but right. That's, and I think this whole life of faith is about, you need to let go of that. And here's the irony. The Bible itself, the people hold on to maintain this almost pamphlet view of the Christian faith, the Bible itself deconstructs that. It doesn't let you stay there. I think that's beautiful. I think that's a Bible worth reading. That's a Bible worth teaching. Not the cookbook, not the owner's manual, not the rule book. Right?
Well, let's give Peter Enns another round of applause.